Hello friend, I hope you all are keeping good health during this pandemic time we all are facing. And of course, this pandemic has impacted the various domain of our life, like social, economical, health, and so on. There's so many negative effect, but at the same time it has some positive note to add. For example, environment, it has given a time for us, especially the earth, to breathe efficiently, and time for the environment to recover and rejuvenate. So this is a very unusual time, and the whole world is very eagerly waiting impatiently that this pandemic will come to an end, and lot of hopes are there, and all are very eagerly waiting for some effective treatment, which is of course in the form of vaccine, and people are waiting that when this vaccine will come out so that we will be protected against this virus. Dear friend, as you know, there is a strong biology of this vaccine is there. For any effective vaccine preparation, the most important thing is to understand the virus itself. So all over the world, people are working around the clock. All scientists in the form of epidemiologists, virologists, biotechnologists, and doctors, all they are working to deal this current situation. So my today's topic, which I call it as GBS, which is the abbreviated form of genotyping by sequencing, one very cost-effective tool used to understand the genomic diversity, because the age which we are living currently is genomic age. So almost we can say that the genetic is come to an halt now. So those days are gone when it was possible to study small fragment of a gene and publish your things. But after the post-genomic sequencing era, it has become very easy to sequence a large genome in a very small span of time. So that's why I say that we are living currently in a genomic era. So genetic is only being confined to now diagnostic labs. So today's my topic is about one such genomic tool, which is a very cost effective and can be applied to many species, ranging from viruses to human. So let's move on. So let's discuss what do you mean by GBS. So GBS, as I said earlier, stands for genotyping by sequencing. So this tool or technique was discovered and invented in the University of Cornell at their genomic diversity study by Hilshire and his colleague in 2011, and they published this finding in PLOS One. So GBS is basically a very simple and straightforward technique to study the whole genome. So now we will discuss what is the methodology of GBS. So dear friend, GBS is basically a technique that allow you scan the whole genome. I said scan. It means that you're not sequencing the whole or entire genome. You are taking a snapshots of the entire genome. So this is very important. Take for example, if there are 3.2 billion base pair in the entire human genome. So GBS will not sequence each and every base. Okay, so GBS, by using GBS, you can scan the entire 3.2, the entire chromosome setup. Okay. It will scan the, right, from chromosome 1 to the 23 pair. And because in GBS, very small fragment is being sequenced. So that's why I said snapshot, not sequencing the whole genome end to end. Okay, so this GBS is basically performed in 5 to 6 basic steps. So as it's being shown in the slide, this, of course, the first step is genomic DNA. You have to obtain the genomic DNA that can be obtained very easily from so many sources like blood, hair, bone, or from any tissue. So it may be from plant, or it may be from animal, or from microbes, and so on. So after you extracted DNA, that DNA is being subjected to a restriction enzyme digestion in step 2, shown in the slide. And here you can choose any restriction enzyme, again depend upon the type of organism you are working. Maybe APEK1, EcoR1, or PST, or so on. So after you cut the entire genome into small fragments, thousands of fragments, those fragments are then ligated with the adapters in the step 3. So these adapters are very important. So these adapters, they are just like the barcodes. Okay, they have particular sequences, and that sequences, they are being added mostly, preferably at the end of this fragmented DNA. So the main purpose of adding this adapter is to use this adapter to reassemble or identify those fragments when we are reassembling the genome. This is a very important step. Selection of adapters means adapters are ligated. In the fourth step, all these adapter ligated fragments, they are pulled in a single tube, and then they are moved to next step, which is a DNA library preparation, which involve now PCR. So by many rounds of PCR, those adapter ligated fragments, they are amplified in so many numbers, and then they are moved to a next final step called as cleanup, because there are some unused DNTPs are there, primers are there that are being removed in the final step. In the last seven step, the last step, all these cleanup PCR fragments which were obtained in the step 6 is being allowed to run on a next generation sequencing sequencer, preferably a Illumina platforms. So here you have a choice. There are so many platforms are available, like the IonTorrent, the Illumina, and Illumina is more preferred than other platform like IonTorrent or Paro sequencing because of so many advantage. That's not possible to discuss here. So, but generally GBS or even RadSeq, which is another technique similar to GBS, which is more common in Europe, okay, they all uses Illumina platform. Even the COVID genome, which is being rapidly being sequenced nowadays, it is being sequenced on Illumina platform. So this fragmented DNA then is which is ligated with adapter is allowed to run through this Illumina platform, and as I said earlier, all these are very short fragments ranging from 80 to 120 base pair. So all those fragments they are being then they are evaluated on the basis of their fragment size, and it is being subjected to dry lab bioinformatic work. So this ends the wet lab work here. So the output of this Illumina is the FASTQ file. FASTQ file, it is not the FASTA file which we obtain generally in the Sanger sequencing method, okay. So it is FASTQ file because this FASTQ file is of very huge size. Take for example the case study which I am going to share with you in my coming slides, which I used in black rat. So I obtained this FASTQ file which was some 29 GB. That was the size of the FASTQ file obtained through this Illumina platform. So this FASTQ file is a very huge file. It's not 25 GB is not a very small size. Okay, it is not MB, not KB. It is 25 GB. So this 25 GB has so many raw sequences. Are you getting me? Means that it is unfiltered. There are so many unwanted stuff is there that you had to get right of that. So in the next slide, as we move on, we will discuss our case study where I use this GBS method to understand the genomic diversity of this black rat from India. And this was the first study where genome-based approach was applied. So we will move to the next slide, and from now you won't see my face except the last few slides. Okay, so let's discuss the case study where I used this GBS. I used the GBS to understand the genomic diversity in black rat. Earlier I used Sanger sequencing method in one of my published study last year, not last year exactly, year before last year, where we sequenced two mitochondrial DNA gene, the cytochrome B and the D loop. So, but that give only a very small snapshot of only two locus, and that too confined to a mitochondrial DNA. So our main idea was to understand the diversity of this black rat covering the entire genome. So we use this GBS, which is very cost effective, to understand or to know the genome diversity. So rattus is commonly called as the black rat. Sometimes it is also called as sheep rat in North America, also called as roof rat there, and also called as house rat. So what is this interesting thing about this rattus or black rat is that it has colonized all major continents of the world, including islands. All this shown in red are the region where black rats are found. And another very amazing and interesting feature is that all these black rat, they trace their ancestry to India, because there are archaeological and some genetic evidences that confirm that India is the origin to this all black rat. Why we attempted this study? Because all previous studies that is being attempted on black rat population include very few samples from India, and that too from a very small geographical region. So understanding phylogeographic pattern within peninsular India is very important to understand the past human migration as well as disease spread by black rat population. Because Rattus rattus or black rat has a long history of commensalism and were transported by human during maritime operations. You can see in the figure, there are evidences which supports that there was a maritime link between the 5000 year old Indus civilization with that of the ancient Sumerian civilization of Near East. There are historical as well as archaeological evidences that supports that there was a trade operation along the east and west coast of India with the Arabian Peninsula. There was the presence of Arabian or Arab sailors in the Indian Ocean who were trading in this region, and probably these Arab sailors, they brought the black rat from the Indian coast to the Arabian Peninsula, and the same Arab sailors then they brought this black rat into the Mediterranean region. Then after the beginning of age of exploration in the 1400 century, the European sailor they brought this black rat into North America and down into South America. What we did in the wet lab, we sampled 34 black rat covering all major regions in India with emphasis on the east coast and the west coast. We also sampled 3 mice to be used as outgroup species in our analysis further. You can see in the figure, all our sampling locations are marked with red dots. We sampled at 16 locations covering the east coast marked with yellow line and the west coast marked with white line. We also sampled few individuals from central India. The black dot represent the archaeological sites from where the rat bones were discovered by the archaeologist. The gray shaded area represent the ancient Indus site where the agriculture and the city life first begin some 5000 to 7000 years ago. And this is a very important region widespread across the northwest of the Indian subcontinent. And probably this is the region where commensalism first originated in the black rat population. We collected tail tips of this black rat. We extracted DNA from this tail tip and subjected this genomic DNA to GBS, also called as genotyping by sequencing, at the genomic diversity facility of Cornell University, Ithaca, New York. So what we did in the dry lab, the first key file obtained from the HI-62500 immunoLAB platform was further filtered and subjected to variant calling against the Rattus norvegicus reference genome. For this purpose, we use the TUSSEL GBS pipeline developed by the Cornell University. This is a very dedicated pipeline for GBS analysis. The VCF file obtained through this filtering process was further used for phylogenomic tree construction. For this purpose, we use SNP phylo pipeline, and the NUIC format tree obtained through this pipeline was further modified in the MEGA5 program. For population structure determination, we use two program, structured
2.3.2 and the Arlequin 3.5.1. Let's move to results now. Out of total 34 Rattus rattus samples collected from 16 locations in India, shown in figure A, only 27 samples yield 1,499 SNPs after filtering. The MLA tree constructed out of these 1,499 SNPs clearly indicates presence of two major clades in the Rattus rattus population, shown in figure B, marked with yellow circle and the pink circle. Down is the green circle, which represents the outgroup species consisting of three mice samples. Another interesting thing this analysis reveals is that this clade correspond to the east coast and the west coast, while the rat from central India goes towards the west coast. The population structure determination using structure and Arlequin also reveal very interesting finding. The structure estimation confirmed the presence of two clades inferred by phylogenetic tree marked with pink and the yellow color in figure C with value of k is equal to 2, while FST estimation using Arlequin show a value of 0.22, a strong indicator of population differentiation. Another interesting thing is the presence of some hybrid individuals in structure analysis marked with arrows in section C. Moving to discussion section now, presence of strong population differentiation in the present day Rattus rattus population inhabiting peninsular India clearly indicates presence of separate origin of commensalism. Also, the Rattus rattus population inhabiting this coast are the ancestral to the central and the west coast population of India, shown with pink circle, which occupy a basal position in the phylogenetic tree, while the population of black rat from central India serving as a hybrid zone between the east and the west coast. So the main driving force for the evolution of commensalism in black rat was the rise of 5,000 year old Indus civilization. You can see in the figure A, all these Indus sites, they are confined to the northwest of the subcontinent, shown in gray shaded area, while these Indus sites are almost absent in the east of the subcontinent. And most probably these two diverse ecological niches within India that might have shaped the genome of black rat differently. Figure B is the ancient Indus port city Lothal, which I visited with my family 2 years ago. In the background you can see the dockyard, and in the figure C, which is the artistic reconstruction of the same dockyard. So coming to the conclusion of this case study, which is about the black rat phylogeographic study. So our case study confirmed that GBS is really a very cost effective technique to understand or study any species at genomic level. And this study also demonstrates that there lies a very strong population structure in black rat population within India, or in simply you can say that the population of black rat which is found on the west coast and on the east coast are genetically different, or you can say that the ancestral population of this black rat is confined to the east coast. So as this study was confined to a very limited sample, 34 samples. So in future, sampling more black rat population from different part of the India, as well as
including some ancient DNA from archaeological sites, would definitely cast more light on the distribution of this black rat within India, as well as the disease spread by this black rat population. So it's the time to thanks all those who help in this endeavor. I'm very thankful to all the viewers for their patience hearing. I'm very much thankful to the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, for awarding me the DBT Crest Fellowship to visit this Cornell University during the year 2015. And I'm also grateful and thankful to Department of Zoology, Sant Gadgil Baba Amravati University, Amravati, especially to Nagpure Madam, Nagle Sir, for providing me an opportunity to interact with you all. And also I'm thankful to my mentor here, Professor Boulding, who provided me the computational facility to analyze all this data on a high-speed computational facility here. And thankful to all my colleagues who help in sampling. For any question, you can email me. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.